Hey guys, how's it going? Chris Chen here. Back in 2014, I made this video that was really well received. A lot of people liked it. And this is kind of like 5 years later, an updated version of it. I just got back from Lightbox Expo in California, and I saw a lot of my friends there. Some of my friends, even though they have really great work, they're not a professional artist yet. It's like, I know these people have what it takes, but they can't seem to find a job. So who is this video for? So if you've already been to art school, you've had art training, you already have a decent portfolio, and you're hardworking, you're constantly doing figure drawing, landscape painting on the weekends, you're producing your own pieces, but you can't seem to get your foot in the door, I think this video is for you. Okay, so step one is to decide. Do whatever it takes attitude, to that conviction, you know? But also deciding which niche you want to specialize in. In film, there's creature, environment, character art. In animation, there's visual development, prop, storyboards, background painter. In games, there's character and environment art. In theme parks, there's illustration, show set designers. And all of these are considered under the umbrella of concept art, but not only is their subject matter what they draw different, and stylistically, they draw differently. For example, a realistic video game versus a mobile video game. It's important to do your homework at this stage to kind of figure out what do you really want to do the most, because it's a lot to specialize in something. Okay, so the next step is to ask for help. I think this is probably the most important step I'm gonna say here, but it's not just that, it's to find an artist who actually has the job you want. Like, you can check out LinkedIn, Instagram, or their portfolio website, check out their resumes. Here, I'm just using LinkedIn to search the job title. And yeah, as you can see, there's a lot of search results. I think at this point, it's important to be specific and find someone who is relevant with the same company and title you're actually looking for. Keep in mind that a lot of people first start out as background or prop designers before they become a lead concept artist. And just ask them for a portfolio review and just do whatever they say. You know, I guess the second most important part is that don't listen to anyone else besides this person, okay? Because your friends might be giving you good art advice, but maybe their advice applies to film instead of game. Or that other person is giving you advice, but it's steering you in the other direction. So I think it's important to find maybe like 3 or 4 people who actually have that job title, and you go and get their professional opinion on how's your portfolio doing, any tips on getting hired, how to apply and stuff like that, headhunters, recruiters, whatever. And one more thing, as I'm editing this video, the last time I made a video like this, there are students asking me for help and they wanted to work in games or film or animation. Don't ask me for advice, because I haven't worked in those industries. I work in theme parks. So any advice that you get from me regarding like games and stuff is going to be inaccurate. It's going to be wrong. So you should be only asking people who work in the industry you want to work in. Would you ask a doctor on advice on how to be an engineer, or an accountant on advice to be a lawyer? Like, it wouldn't make sense. In fact, after this piece of advice, you wouldn't even need to listen to anything else I said. You know, I think just find the person who has the job you're looking for and get their input on your particular portfolio. And one last thing, if this professional takes their time to give you a portfolio critique, please say thank you and respond. Or even better, implement the advice that they gave you and show them the improvements that you've made. Many students don't even do this step and don't even say thank you, from my experience. So the bar's not set really high, just do this. Next, if you still wanna listen, copy, all right? So a lot of teachers say, oh, just copy old masters, like Rembrandt, Sargent, stuff like that, and do small composition thumbnails. You know, that's usually what I hear a lot of teachers say, but I think you should be copying professional work and doing really detailed studies, okay? And this is what I'm talking about here. This is really kind of controversial because I don't hear anyone else suggesting this. Like, I've done a study of a Glenn Keane piece, Rapunzel, and I think this took about like 30 hours. It was really detailed, but I learned a lot, you know? there's this other piece I copied, Victoria Ying's piece, and it was more stylized, kind of graphic, and it was way harder than I thought it would be, even though I thought it looked simple. Again, I learned a lot. And also, I copied this theme park piece, this bird's eye view, and learned a lot from that as well. Again, 8 to 30 hours, it took me all week. And I want to say, I think it's a misconception that artists get hired based on how good you are, because I think how good you are is subjective. You know, there's so many different ways you can judge it in terms of composition, storytelling, color. How good you are is really vague. Instead, let's think about, can you perform at a certain level that is required, right? That becomes a yes or no question, and it's objective, you know? So your quality of work and finish that you are copying, studying right now, that's a standard, that's a baseline you need to be at. So when I was copying all of this, I was doing straight up color picking. I was tracing, the thing was on top. And the reason is I'm kind of skipping the first 90%. I'm taking a shortcut from the first 90% because I'm just focusing on the end. And I've read in Tim Ferriss's book, this is where I learned it, that a lot of chess masters, they start with the end in mind, with they're only practicing with the end couple piece, like king, queen, pawn, whatever, because the goal of chess is to win. And it doesn't matter what you did previously leading up to the ending, but you have to win the game. So when you're creating a piece, that last finish, that last 10%, 5%, takes a lot of mastery and skill. And this is the point of this exercise, to really practice your finish and see what it takes to get to that professional level. Okay, next step is to create. Create your own work. And again, I want to say it's important that it be on the same level of the people that you found the artist, the professional artist. That is the standard. So one of my tips is to create a different version of an existing professional piece. So here's an example. Here's Eric Hishong's work, Tomorrowland, a theme park painting. And here's mine. And it's a kind of Tomorrowland Tron kind of thing. And as you can notice, they're really similar. You know, I did everything from scratch. I drawn everything myself. But as you can see, the layout is the same, the buildings are the same. However, the only thing that is different is the design is different and the mood is different. It's at night. So it's really familiar, but it's also different at the same time. And you don't want to copy or plagiarize someone else's work, okay? That's cheating, that's bad. But you do want people to believe that it's professional work. In fact, this piece, a lot of people actually believe it's concept, real Disney concept art of the Tron Tomorrowland, and like Disney blogs were posting about it, and I had to be like, no, this is just personal work I did for a class, you know, back like in 2013. It's not actually for Disney or anything like that. I didn't even know they were building Tron Tomorrowland in Shanghai. But I think it's a testament to this effective technique protocol. And I do have a friend, professional friend, I won't say his name just in case, but he said when he was a student, he was creating concept art, you know, just for fun, of Uncharted 3, right? It was so good and so believable that he actually got an email or a call from the company themselves, and they were like, hey, you need to take this artwork down. You shouldn't be releasing this stuff. It's NDA, whatever. And then they wrote back saying like, whoa, we're just students. We didn't actually work on this real project. But you can see the studio actually thought their work was so good. The studio actually thought that they were professionals working on the team. So that's the level you need to be at. And I know it sounds hard, but here's the thing. A professional usually has like 3 or 4 days to work on a concept art, sometimes even one day. As a student, they have no idea how long you're spending on this. You can take up to a month. Like I've taken up to a month. Sometimes even 2 months just working on the thing, but you'll get faster. You know, when you're looking at a portfolio site, there's no timestamp of, oh, he spent 1 month on this piece, we're not going to hire him. Like, they don't know that. So that's something at your advantage. Okay, next step, of course, send it out. I was only sending out like 3 pieces plus my portfolio. And I think that was enough. You know, I was emailing it in an attachment. And I just do it, you know, find the contacts and email them and follow up and stuff like that. And quick side note, you may have heard of the quote, it's not what you know, but who you know. I think this is just a huge disservice if you have a bad portfolio. When I was starting out, I had friends at DreamWorks, Disney, Blizzard. Even if you have a lot of friends and your work sucks, you're not gonna get a job. Okay, so closing, I do wanna say, having done this particular protocol, get a job, this technique, there are pros and cons. So the pro is that your quality goes up, right? You become a subject matter expert at whatever niche that you want. And you also have a stylistic match, you know, to the companies and the job you want. However, there are some cons, okay? One, this doesn't guarantee your speed or produce the quantity needed. So when I first got a job, the pace was so fast. And that was really difficult for me, but, you know, I got there. And doing this doesn't mean that you're fast. Another thing is that this doesn't really help with your problem solving or ability to design. So this kind of glosses over that. And another thing is, maybe you get the job you want, but you're not necessarily happy. But I think that's good, you know? You won't know if you don't like the job unless you try it, all right? Like, there's no answer. So when I first started in concept art, like, all my friends, they were in games, so I wanted to do games. So I got some freelance concept art things and I didn't like it because I realized, wait, I don't even play video games, what am I doing? So then, I got some film jobs, you know, some animation, character design, but I didn't really like that either. And finally, I was like, you know, I want to do theme parks. You know, I like how everyone's happy, everyone's bright. I'm doing characters and environments and props. And I kind of like the combination of everything. And my background's in industrial design. And I felt like everything kind of meshed together. I liked it. So it may take you a little while to find what your niche is and what really fits for you. And just a reminder, there's no substitute for things such as hard work, patience, persistence, passion, and having fun. Okay, summary. So, one, decide that you'll do whatever it takes. And you also need to decide what niche you will want to go for and right now, which company, which style, which subject matter. Figure it out and just do it. Second, ask for help. So, ask a working professional at that company who has that job title for advice. Now with LinkedIn, it's easier than ever to find those people. 10 years ago, you would have to know like a personal connection or a friend of a friend to be able to know what their email address is. But now you can just slip into their DMs and stuff. With the internet, everything's pretty easy. Don't get offended and be respectful if they don't respond, you know? Just email 10 people, you know, and maybe 2 out of 10 respond. And that's really normal. Number 3, copy, you know, bring your work to the professional level so you know what it takes to be there. And of course, I'm assuming that you already have a really solid fundamental skill and you just need that last 10% push. So this kind of hones your skill to the next level, sharpens your knife to that last edge. Number 4, you need to create some original work. And again, it's important that it be at the same level. It's objective, okay? So you need to put your portfolio and their portfolio side by side, and they need to look like they could be working at the same company, you know? It's really objective where, hey, they're at the same level, or no, this guy's nowhere near that level. And lastly, number 5, just send it out. Be respectful, be persistent, wish for the best, and hopefully this helps. You know, I know there's a lot of artists out there with really good skills. And if you need that last push to find a job, hopefully this helps. All right. Thanks. Bye.
Doing always beats thinking. Do it, bro. Just do it. Like, okay. I don't understand. I mean, just make. Like, all this overthinking. Yeah. Like, I'm just so tired of everybody overthinking. Whether it was the best use of your time or not, actually doing it is better. Like, people spend so much time debating that even if they would have done the wrong thing, they still had more time on their hand. I like doing and finding out I'm wrong and still saving time. Everyone so values their time, or they're so insecure about people judging their decision that they don't fucking make.